Where do we stand in the Middle East?
Well, our government tells us that we stand with an even-handed posture, which to me means we're standing on our head, because it's all mixed up. Even-handed means both sides have kind of equal rights, and that certainly isn't true in the Middle East. The Egyptians have sworn to destroy Israel and to drive the Jews into the sea, whereas Israel, a member of the United Nations, asks only what is its right to live freely, independently, behind recognized and secure frontiers. And it seems to me the United States should stand strongly with Israel, for that is the right of every member of the United Nations. Furthermore, Israel is a democratic and Western-oriented country, the kind that we ought to be supporting, and we're really not, particularly when it's under very severe attack from the Soviet Union, which is sending arms to its enemies to destroy it. Now, in 25 years as a reporter around the world, I've seen country after country scream for American help, and all they have to do is to mention the magic word, Soviet Union. We've helped the Greeks and the Turks. We've sent Marines into Lebanon. We've sent Marines into Santo Domingo. We've sent how many of our young men to fight and die in Vietnam in the name of stopping communist and Russian advances? Why do we not stand with Israel?
When we follow a course designed as it is that precipitates the kind of resentment and defiance of law and order, and in a sense sanctioned by our leadership, you find various dissident groups taking the law into their own hands and acting on their own. This is the same thing that was true in the days of the heyday of the Ku Klux Klan, the black shirts and the red shirts in this country, where there was some unspoken sanction for their actions. So they took the law into their own hands. When our governor says that he doesn't have an idea of what his role is as a leader of this state, it is certainly disquieting and should be alarming to all of our Texas citizens. To whom should we look for leadership if our governor doesn't know what he's supposed to do? The state gladly added up the funds year after year to bus Negroes past 2 and 3 white schools to keep them out of quality schools. They did it for more than 100 years. Now, because it says that some kids who are not classified as minorities are going to be bused to bring about integration and a balance in the school system, it becomes criminal and immoral. The same leaders who advocated segregation then and busing then are the ones who are denouncing it now.
Charlotte, what happened this morning?
Well, when I drove up outside, I noticed a little guy sitting outside by the curb, and I just went ahead and drove in, and then when I stopped my car, well, he opened the door and got in with me, and he stuck a gun in my side, and he said, "You just be calm and go inside and take out all the money you got and put it in a bag." He said, "Do what I tell you and nobody will get hurt." So I came inside and put the money in a little bag, and he shut me up in the back room back there until he looked outside and didn't see anybody, so then he left.
What about the Vietnam situation? Or do you feel that we're getting out of there fast enough, or you feel that all the troops should come home at one time?
Well, you can't bring all the troops home at one time. That's logistically impossible. But I think it is quite easy to arrange an orderly and an honorable withdrawal from Vietnam by withdrawing 50,000 troops a month. And in 9 months, why, they'll all be out. Now, that's not cutting and running. That's almost a year's time. Seems to me reasonable, and seems to me within the terms of what we set out to do. Our government keeps telling us we have to maintain a commitment in Vietnam, and it seems that the time has come when we could say quite truly and honorably that we have fulfilled our commitment. After all, no commitment is forever, and we took a commitment 5 years ago, 1965, when we sent in our first combat troops to help the South Vietnamese resist the communist attack.